dream become a nightmare? When do we do what must be done? When do we stand and face the future when there is nowhere left to run? And you got to learn just how to survive. You got to learn how to keep your dream alive. Take a look at my face, I am the future. How do you like what you see? Take a look at my face, I belong to the future.
Hey, gals and guys, this is Michael Ferrari's Cinema de Meep. Welcome to the 38th bonus Patreon episode. And joining me today, school's in with Daniel Archer.
Hey.
How's it going, Daniel?
Yeah, it's good. I'm good.
Calling all the way from Nice.
From freezing Nice. Actually, tonight I'm podcasting in bed. I'm under the covers. my heat isn't working, so I'm in my bathrobe having a nice Bordeaux and talking to you. So
nice.
Best way to podcast.
Yeah. It's not quite evening here. We're 6 hours apart, so it's the afternoon. It would be like lunchtime at school right now. So I'm spending my lunch hour instead of on the playground or in the cafeteria with you. So so what are we talking about today? We're doing teacher movies. Why teacher movies? I feel like this is a topic we've been talking about doing for a long time. We finally got to it. Why?
Yeah, we're going back to school. Well, I mean, this is a subject that's near and dear to me. I was a teacher for a long time and recently decided to leave classroom teaching, but I'm still working in a sort of teaching adjacent field. Mm-hmm. So teaching is part of me, and I'm married to a teacher. He teaches first and second grade.
Oh, nice.
So yeah. And yeah, I don't know. I just always really dig seeing different representations of teachers in movies. In fact, I remember with my colleagues, we would always play this game, like, what movie teacher are you? Mm-hmm. And so I got a lot of different responses whenever we played that game.
Now, did the person you picked, is that person on this list of yours today, or is it just like something different?
Yeah, I'm kind of a composite, I think, of a few of these, but mm-hmm. I don't want to say who, because...
Let's play this game later. After we get our list, maybe.
Yeah.
That sounds fun. I've never been a teacher. I've barely been a student. It's been so long. But I do really respect teachers, and being a parent of two kids who are in first grade and fourth grade, I really respect what teachers do, and especially for kids that age, because it's just, you know, it's not easy, it's not well respected, underpaid. There's a lot of reasons why the field itself is just something that's so honorable. So I like seeing them in films, and I like seeing, you know, it seems kind of crazy to say that I like seeing teachers sometimes go through the ringer in these movies, or just sometimes a lot of these movies where you just kind of see their personal lives, not in the classroom. I think that's a good mix of seeing teachers on film, and whether it be in the classroom or in their everyday life. Certainly my list, there's quite a few of those. And I believe in yours too. I just think it's a fun way just to take a look at a genre or subgenre like this, and not just confine it to one space in a classroom always.
Yeah. Or says, one narrative. I mean, I think right. we get so caught up in like the teacher as savior narrative yes. that it could actually be, it could be potentially damaging to the teacher because you feel like you have to live up to this expectation. But then I think it places, of course, you know, parents have all of these expectations of teachers based on these movies, maybe, or representations of teachers. And mm-hmm. yeah, I've kind of got a problem with that. And actually, I'm sure you heard it, but I was just listening to the Projection Booths podcast mm-hmm. of just one of the guys. Did you hear that?
I just listened to it, yes.
Yeah. And coincidentally enough, they talked about the teachers in that movie. And how that's a really good example of a film where you don't really see good examples of teachers. Like, you know, there's no savior teacher in Just One of the Guys.
Right. And if anything, they're a little bit questionable on how they,
So, yeah, I always think it's interesting when movies move away from that kind of, you know, cliche.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the 90s, I think, were like a booming time for the savior teacher movie.
Oh, for sure.
There are definitely examples. We won't point them out, pick on them, you know, because well, you know what they well are.
Loved. Yeah,
they're well loved. They did well. They definitely struck a chord with people, and that's totally cool. But I think the movies that we're going to try to focus in on, the movies that we have a personal relationship with, or something that connect to us for whatever reason, as silly or as, you know, for whatever reason it is. And we'll talk about them, of course. Before we do that, let's get into our recently seen. I know I have a very short list only because I did a podcast quite recently, but I want to hear what you've been watching lately.
It's almost Christmas, and so I've been looking for good Christmas movies to watch. And I stumbled upon Single All the Way.
That's me opening my pretend beer.
Okay. So I don't know. Yay, gay representation. yay, Jennifer Coolidge. I don't know. It's a Christmas movie. How you don't judge a Christmas movie. You just watch a Christmas movie, you know, and you're into it or you're not into it. Mm-hmm. This one I was actually kind of into it, you know, and mm-hmm. I don't know what it is, like just the kind of like boring relationship movie. Normally I wouldn't be into this, but if you throw a Christmas tree into the background, like I'm so there for it. So far that's the only Christmas movie I've watched. But in terms of like newer movies, maybe this isn't new to you, because in France we sometimes get movies a little bit late, but I just watched Spencer, the Princess Diana movie.
Yeah, how was that?
Well, I was surprised. I actually really, really liked it. In fact, I think it's one of my favorites of the year. And I'm surprised because I'm a little over all of the Princess Diana content, for lack of a better word. And I was never like enamored really with her as a public figure. You know, I know a lot of people were. She just wasn't a part of my life. But I thought Kristen Stewart was really good. I liked the energy of this movie. It's, I think it's a pretty strong film. And then besides that, I've also seen, The Power of the Dog, the new Jane Campion film mm-hmm. on Netflix.
Yeah, my wife wants to see that.
Love, love, love this movie. I mean, it's so nice to see Jane Campion making a movie again. Benedict Cumberbatch is great. I don't even know, is that how you say his name?
Yeah, Cumberbatch, yeah.
Cumberbatch. And I don't know. I mean, think Dark Brokeback Mountain. You know, this is like mm-hmm. a dark version of that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's so interesting. I really dug it. What else? Titan. Do you know this movie, Titan?
Yeah, I've heard of it.
Yeah, it's Titan, French for titanium. It was the Palme d'Or this year. Okay, so I just got to say, this is not a movie for everyone. If you are into movies where homicidal women transition into boys, but before that they have sex with the car, And then later in the movie, they give birth to like a car baby. You will like this movie. It's a very niche audience.
Sounds a little Cronenberg-y, maybe.
A bit. Yeah. Lots of body horror. Mm-hmm. Also, lots of interesting stuff about gender fluidity. Mm-hmm. And you know, I've seen it twice. The first time I was really on the fence. The second time I loved it. But it's not a movie I would just like flat out recommend for everybody. So, and then, you know, shout out to Night Flight Plus. So I have been a subscriber to Night Flight Plus for about a year now. Man, that app is giving me my life. I think I wake up every weekend, I find something. Last weekend, I watched a movie called Johnny Firecloud. I've never heard of Johnny Firecloud, but it was amazing. And I originally subscribed to this app because I grew up watching like New Wave. What is that? I'm forgetting the names. New Wave something. It's some of the other programming that they used to do. That's why I got it. But they have all of these relationships with, you know, different film distributors, Arrow and Grindhouse, you know, and all of these great companies. So, yeah, I've been watching a lot of Night Flight Plus lately. And then another shout out to Chucky, which I heard you talk about on your last podcast with Jeffrey. And Chucky is blowing my mind. I just finished it, actually. And I can't believe how much I love Chucky. So my relationship with the Child Play films has been a little uneven. I'd say as they went on, I love them more and more. Like later ones that get really crazy and subversive and gay. Like I'm so into them. And then this, like, Chucky, to me, it's like the greatest of all of the Chucky content. I keep saying content, like films. I loved the relationship between Jake and Devin. And I love that they bring back all of these characters. And yeah, it's just so good. And then I guess final shout out to you and Jeffrey Berg. I was telling you before the podcast, like I've been listening to your 1991 series and I absolutely love it. Hats off to you guys. That was a big project. And you did an amazing job covering those films and I can't wait to go back and watch a lot of them. 1991 was a big year for me. I graduated from high school in 91. So those movies have a big place in my life. So that's it for me.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, yeah, that was, yeah, obviously there was a reason why I had to cover 91. I graduated in 92, but you know, all those movies were just so, you know, ingrained in me that
yeah,
I had to exercise that 91 demon and do that podcast, that series of podcasts, and I'm glad I did. I'm also glad you're enjoying Night Flight Plus. That's a great app, and I love the stuff on
so
there.
So good.
My friend Cara Jean is part of that, and she's, you know, just doing great work. And it comes from a place of pure love too, which I really admire, obviously. All right, so not a lot, like I mentioned. Two things in particular. Well, last night I just felt like watching a Christmas movie. I watched two Christmas movies recently so far. It's the only, I think, mostly Christmas stuff besides all the kids, you know, the kids' Christmas things. I watched Christmas Evil, which is probably my second favorite Christmas horror movie after the original Black Christmas. I'm a huge fan of Christmas Evil. I love it. It just really captures kind of horror movie that was coming out around this time, where it's like from the killer's point of view kind of thing, like a Maniac or a Don't Go in the House, or you know, those kinds of horror movies that were happening then. But it does it in a way that's quite unique and quite magical. Let's put it that way. It has one of the best endings to a movie ever. And I just love it. I really do. It just gets better and better in each viewing for me. It's a character study, but it's also a Christmas slasher. And It's very dark and twisted, but it has a sense of humor about itself as well, which I really admire. It's a lot of things. So it's, to me, a perfect Christmas horror movie.
Yeah, I haven't seen that in a long... I have. I haven't seen it in a while. I'm going to have to add that to my list this year. The other night, we did watch Silent Night, Deadly Night. But yeah, I would love to watch Christmas Evil again.
And I like Silent Night, Deadly Night. It was a little rough for me seeing that as a kid. In the theater. I actually watched the first two movies in the theater. These days, I kind of prefer part two. Only because I know part two is famous for having like half of its footage being the first movie. But that's kind of what I like about it, because you get the best parts of part one in part two. And then you have all the crazy over-the-topness of the new footage in part two. So it's like getting two movies in one. So that's
true.
Like a nice gift for me. The other Christmas movie I watched was on Netflix. I don't know why I watched this movie. Because I never watch these kinds of movies, but I'm like, I feel compelled to watch this movie. And it was A Castle for Christmas. Starring Brooke Shields and Carrie Elwes. Kind of famous novelist who kind of like does something embarrassing, and then she kind of runs away to Scotland to get away from the press. And
does she go to a castle?
And she goes to a castle that her dad had some sort of he had something to do with it. And then Carrie Elwes is he takes care of the castle, and then she's there to buy it. So she has quite a few dollars. And then of course, you know, they hate each other. It's like one of those hate each other and then will they fall in love with each other kind of movies, which, you know, I like all those screwball comedies from the 30s, and that was the basic premise of a lot of those movies. So it kind of carries it over here in a cozy Christmas kind of movie setting in Scotland. And it was actually shot in Scotland. It has a lot of that, you know, it has a lot of that atmosphere. It's a very silly movie. It's a nicer Lifetime movie, you know, or more well-produced Lifetime movie.
Okay.
Because it's Netflix and they clearly have a budget.
Yeah.
And I like the pairing of Brooke Shields and Carrie Elwes. Carrie Elwes in the beginning kind of he's the kind of actor that I like. But I guess because of the roles he's been playing the last 20 years or so, like, he kind of plays people who are a little bit like shady. So I was like, what is this guy up to? Like, I thought he was going to come up, like, be a killer or something. But no. He just takes care of the castle. He's grumpy.
It's not a Christmas murder in a castle.
You're right. And also because it was directed by Mary Lambert, who was the great music video director, Mary Lambert, who helmed one of the better Stephen King movies, Pet Sematary. So I'm like, okay, is this gonna have a heart of it? Because Mary Lambert. No, it's just well directed and made. It's very very slight but enjoyable.
Okay, A Castle for Christmas.
A movie I would never usually recommend, and I'm not actually recommending it because you have to be into those movies to like it. And I'm not a Christmas movie person. I'm not a Christmas guy. So So it was kind of like a thing that I threw on in a rainy afternoon.
Okay.
And then the other one I wanted to mention was I talked about in the last podcast my recently seen was Last Night in Soho. So that was that review was from the theatrical screening that I went to. I watched it at home. I was streaming. I'm like, okay, I need to watch this movie again, because there were things about the theatrical screening. I liked it, but I just didn't appreciate it as much, I guess. There were things that kind of bothered me about the movie. But watching it again, so I'm going to revise my opinion on this movie. I definitely enjoyed it a lot more. It's really well done from top to bottom. The music choices are like amazing, and it's just really, you get caught up in it, even though it gets pretty silly towards the last part of the movie. There's some ghosty things maybe, or there's elements about it that kind of like, oh, I'm not quite sure that works, but I'll go along for the ride this time. Okay. Instead of the first time, I was a little bit like, oh, why? You know, like, no, don't do that. So I'm a little bit, I was definitely much more along for the ride this time, and I really enjoyed it. And can't wait for the Blu-ray to come out and or 4K, whatever. So.
Yeah, so that has just arrived here. And so I'm looking at that, or West Side Story, mm-hmm. or, you know, Ghostbusters. Like, there's everything suddenly arrived at once. I haven't seen it yet, but okay. Yeah, I want to. Yeah.
I won't spoil it. I almost did, but I don't. I won't. It's really well done. You know, Edgar, if you like his movies, it's definitely, you got to get a lot of great stuff in it, and a lot of great needle drops, of course. That's it. Let's get into our list. We have, doing our fives. We could do some honorable mentions beforehand.
Okay.
Get those out of the way.
Yeah, I have some of those. Let's see. Well, you know, so originally my list included Stepping Out with Liza, mm-hmm. because okay. I love Stepping Out. Although it's funny what I ended up replacing this.
Oh yeah, I have no clue. I don't think I got this revision, so I'm very curious.
This was originally my number five, but okay. I have a new number five. But yeah, I love this movie. You just covered this with Jeffrey, which made me very happy. And because I don't think it's a movie that's gotten a lot of love. I mean, no one really saw it when it came out, you know, and I saw it on video. But, a must watch for any Liza fan. She plays a mm-hmm. dance teacher with this ragtag group of adults learning how to like tap dance and stuff like that. And it's mm-hmm. really sweet. But on the opposite end, I love Isabelle Huppert in The Piano Teacher at her sadistic best. She's so good in that.
Mm-hmm. That's a really good movie. I really like that. I saw that in the Angelica and or the Sunshine Theater. I think Angelica, and I was kind of blown away by it.
So great. And she's so nasty, putting like broken pieces of glass in that girl's jacket pocket. And speaking of nasty, Judi Dench in Notes on a Scandal, where she discovers Cate Blanchett is having an affair with a boy. And then she herself is probably in love with Cate Blanchett. There's like this whole lesbian psychodrama thing happening. Mm-hmm. Have you seen Notes on a Scandal?
Yeah, I have. And I remember it feeling kind of like a bit like of a 70s movie, which I liked. Felt a little bit out of its time, which because there were a lot of movies in the 2000s that I wasn't keen on.
That one felt a little
out of its time, which I liked a lot.
Yeah. Who else? Well, I mean, obviously, Diane Keaton would have made my list. Teresa Dunn and Looking for Mr. Goodbar, Teacher by Day, Swinger by Night. but I just talked about her in the last podcast I did with you, Apartment Horror. But shout out to Teresa Dunn. Mm-hmm. I really liked last year's Another Round. I think that's what I forget what this movie was called in the US. It's the movie with Mads Mikkelsen. And mm-hmm. he plays a teacher who's drinking all the time. Is that what it's called? Another Round?
Actually, I don't know this one. So,
okay. Yeah, we had a different title, but that was really good. And then, well, so I don't want to say anything about the teacher as savior because those movies have their place, I guess. Mm-hmm. I'm not as in love with Dangerous Minds as I am in love with the Gangster's Paradise video. I absolutely love when Michelle Pfeiffer like pulls up that chair mm-hmm. and she gets schooled by Coolio and she's like, okay, you want to tell me what this is all about? It is such an iconic 90s moment that, mm-hmm. you know.
Right.
So good. Who else? Kevin Klein in In-N-Out, where he plays the teacher who gets outed by Matt Dillon. Mm-hmm. Victor Wong in Prince of Darkness. He takes his class on a field trip to like the gates of hell.
I didn't even think of that. that's a great choice.
Yeah. And then of course they're like all of the TV teachers, Walter White, Mr. Carter, Mr. Jellyneck, and Mr. Noblet from Strangers with Candy. They're so funny.
He lives in New Jersey.
Yeah.
In the old the town we moved from there, I won't say it on here, but he lives there and he's like neighbors with our good friends. And
they
see him all the time and they see Amy Sedaris over all the time.
Oh, that's cool. He was great on that show.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, I've got a lot more, but that's a good start. What about you?
That's a great list. Okay. My list is a little bit long, so I'll just go through it quickly. After Midnight from 1989, it's one of those anthology movies, late 80s anthology movies. The wraparound story revolves a teacher in a classroom, and then some bad stuff may happen. He's quite a teacher. Have you seen this one?
No.
I urge you to check it out. It's okay. Probably definitely one of my favorite anthology horror movies. It's very 80s. And cool. Pamela Adlon or Pamela Segal, she's in it. It's got a lot of recognizable people in it from like, especially from TV of that time period. The teacher is quite, his teaching methods are quite unusual to say the least. We'll put it that way. That's After Midnight. Bad Teacher oh my God, I'm blanking on her name.
Cameron Diaz.
Yes. Rest in peace, Cameron Diaz, who apparently retired from acting after doing the awful Annie remake. But she was doing a lot of movies around this time period. Like, she was doing one after the other. I could see why she probably would have got burnt out. But the gem in all of those movies of that time period, this is 2011, is Bad Teacher, where she does in fact play a bad teacher, and she's quite hilarious in it. A good teacher, Conrack. That's a kind of a well-known 70s dramatic teacher movie. I thought it's very gritty and real. It's a good film. I did put Dead Poets Society on my list. So that's not, again, usually a movie I go for, but that one kind of, I watched it a couple years back and I remember feeling like, oh, I like this movie a lot more now than when I was 14 when it came out. It's not a movie I'll watch a lot, but I think it's pretty good. It's well done. It's Peter Weir, of course.
So, you know, when we would talk about which teachers like inspired us to be teachers, or which teachers, who would we be? That mm-hmm. was always the top choice. Like, yeah. So many teachers, yeah, I know were inspired by that movie or the Edward James Olmos movie.
Right. Stand and
Lean
Deliver.
On Me.
Or Lean On. Stand, no, and Stand and Deliver, yes. And then Lean On Me is the more famous one. Yeah, those are always in the, if you look at the list for all the top like teacher movies, you'll see Dead Poets, Lean On Me, and Stand and Deliver. And I get it, because they were pretty popular and well-loved.
Yeah.
Not as well-loved Devil in the Flesh, starring Rose McGowan from the late 90s. This is where she's kind of stalking a teacher. It's not really from her point of view. I mean, it's not really from his point of view, the teacher's point of view, but it does switch point of views at some points. It's quite silly. And she's pretty funny in it. But it's fun to watch. Educating Rita, the Michael Caine movie. And Julie Walters, of course. I actually watched it recently. I hadn't seen it and a long, long, long time. So I kind of forgot it, and it's really well done. Election, I talked about this movie on the 99 podcast. You gotta love Election. Fast Break, the 1979 basketball movie with Gabe Kaplan. I don't have any, I guess that's my sports, my sports teacher, or I guess coach representation on this list. Hamlet 2. Which is a very funny movie. Hard Promises, I wrote down. That's where Sissy Spacek plays a teacher whose ex-husband comes into town, and that's, he's played by William Peterson, and ruffles some feathers, and her feathers, because she's about to get married to somebody else. It's a gem of a movie, and I'll probably talk about it on our 1992 podcast. Husbands and Wives, another 92 movie gem.
For sure.
The Woody Allen film. Kindergarten Cop, I wrote on my list. Entertaining film. He didn't make a lot of great, those kind of comedies. Like there were a lot of those kid related comedies, and, you know, Jingle All the Way is, you know, a beloved one, but Kindergarten Cop is definitely, to me, the best of those movies. Yeah. Liana, the John Sayles film, about a woman who takes up a relationship with her teacher, and that's a great film. I talked about that before. Link from 1986, Terrence Stamp as a mad scientist professor. Mr. Holland's Opus, again, one of those mid-90s like popular teacher movies. I hadn't seen it since the mid-90s. Watched it very recently and was quite moved by it. I put it down here, a double feature of Night School and Pieces. yeah, Pieces is obviously pretty well known by horror fans. It's a crazy over-the-top movie. Night School from 81 stars Rachel Ward as an anthropology student who takes it up with her professor, and it's quite a movie. Have you seen that one?
I haven't seen it.
Add that to your list.
But I have seen Pieces. I love Pieces.
And we'll be talking about Rachel Ward soon.
Yes.
The Object of My Affection. I wrote that down. I think it's a charming movie. I don't usually like Jennifer Aniston movies, but that's the one that I liked. Paul Rudd's really good in that. Pretty Maids All in a Row from 1971. Talked about that movie before, where The Rock Hudson as a very questionable teacher. His practices are very questionable, to say the least. The Prime of Miss Jane Brody from 1969, Maggie Smith.
Good one.
The Reincarnation of Peter Proud, 75. I wrote down Sing from 1989, only because I like to mention that movie, because almost nobody talks about that movie anymore. And that movie's worth it alone to see. Lorraine Bracco is a teacher who likes to dance.
I discovered that movie because of you. You've talked about it before. Yeah,
it's great. The Substitute from 1996. That's the movie about a kind of CIA kind of guy who becomes a substitute teacher to find the guy who hurt his girlfriend in a very bad high school in Florida. That's Tom Berenger. It's very entertaining. I had a lot of fun watching that movie. I tried watching
Sorry, go ahead.
I just tried watching the sequel. It's not as good, but the first one's great.
No, I was just going to say something about Florida, but I don't need to say anything about Florida.
Oh, yeah. Because Florida. Yeah. Why is this school so bad? Because Florida. it is really bad in the movie. It's quite crazy. Surviving Desire, the Hal Hartley film. To Sir with Love, that's another one that makes a lot of lists. Under the Sand from 2000. Walk Like a Man from 1987. I only put that on here because you get to watch Amy Steele from Friday the 13th Part 2 try to teach Howie Mandel to walk like a man. So that's fun for that alone. And also the wacky mall shenanigans in it. When Night is Falling from 1995, another student teacher relationship movie. Wild Things from 98. Matt Dillon is a very questionable teacher. And then, my other coach movie, that's Goldie Hawn in Wildcats.
I love Wildcats. Good choice.
Talk that one about that one plenty. So let's hear, what's your number five, your mystery number five, since I have no clue what it is.
Okay. Well, I'm going to start off with esteemed professor of literature, respected scholar of Shakespeare, Professor Sybil Danning. And they're playing with fire.
Oh, of course. Yes.
Yeah.
Let's play a trailer for it right here.
On a campus with plenty of available girls, all willing to learn, what more could a college student want?
Come on. I'll show you.
It's the kind of education no co-ed can offer and no textbook could teach. Eric Brown, the star of Private Lessons, goes to the head of the class when English professor Sybil Danning gives him an A+ for extracurricular activities.
They're playing with fire, Jay.
They're playing with fire. Rated R.
Oh, you're playing with fire.
Okay, so Professor Sybil Danning. Where do I start with this movie? So... why did I choose this movie? Because I'm kind of obsessed with those like 80s glamazon women, you know, like Brigitte Nielsen and Grace Jones and Sybil Danning. And I've always been kind of fascinated by Sybil Danning. But the whole idea of Sybil being like an English professor, it's a little bit crazy, right? And in this movie, it's especially crazy. So when we first see her, she is going through her early morning pre-teaching ritual. She apparently lives on like a yacht.
As you do.
And as you do, because when you're a teacher, you have yacht money, right? And she
part of your allowance as a teacher is to have the, yeah. Yacht allowance, yeah.
Yeah, after you get tenure, you get the yacht. That's how it works usually. So she throws on her little tiny bikini, and then she goes up to the deck of the boat, and she just sort of like sunbathes and presumably lesson plans for the day while she's baking in the sun. Mm-hmm. This opening scene, it is so funny to me. So they've got her in this like teeny little bikini, and you're watching it and you're like, okay, is that bikini top gonna hold in all the boobs and all the breasts and all the, you know, all the stuff that's in there? Like, it's just threatening to explode, but it doesn't. And in the next scene, you see her cool, calm, and collected walking across campus in full teacher drag. Like, they've got the glasses on her. Her hair is like parted down the middle and pulled back, which is something I love about teacher movies. It doesn't matter who the actor is. If you just throw on like a big pair of Sally Jesse Raphael glasses and pull their hair back, voila, instant teacher. Even Sybil Danning. So she's in like full on teacher drag. And then she goes into her class where she delivers a lecture about Macbeth, and she straightens out that dangling modifier problem happening in her male student's pants. and then in that scene, she invites one of her students over to like clean her boat or something, and she seduces him. And so this becomes like a whole movie about a teacher seducing a student. And it is so crazy, so over the top and ridiculous, but I think it's really, really fun. I mean, it has all of these insane plot twists. I mean, it's like an episode of Dynasty, where basically Sybil Danning is bored with her life, but she's married to another teacher, and they want to somehow like get inheritance money from her husband's family. And their way of doing that is by scaring the family out of their house. And then the movie kind of like seeks into like a passion romance thing between teacher and student. And then by the end, it becomes a kind of quasi slasher with Sybil Danning. If you ever want to see Sybil Danning as a kind of quasi final girl, yeah, this is the movie for you. And I love Sybil in this movie. And the other thing I wanted to say about the movie is that the student that she seduces is Eric Brown, who is also the same kid that was in the movie Private Lessons, only in that movie, he was being seduced by another kind of, I guess, a sort of quasi-teacher, Sylvia Crystal. I mean, she teaches them how to have sex, so I guess she's the maid, and she's also the sex ed teacher. And I don't know, have you seen Private Lessons recently?
Oh yeah, that's an infamous movie.
I felt gross. Like, I forgot. Like, he's like a 14-year-old boy who's having sex with, you know, Sylvia Crystal. It's crazy, but. I don't, there was this whole sort of like subgenre in the early 80s of like young male student types hooking up with older female teacher types. I mean, another good example was My Tutor with Karen Kay. Was that her name? Yeah. And My Tutor is another, I mean, in that movie, the boy is sleeping with his French tutor. And I just watched this too, you know, so I speak French, but I got to tell you, the French that she's teaching him, it's crazy. Like pommes frites, the word for French fries. Like, I can't tell you how many times
you need to know that
French fries comes up in daily conversation, zero times. So,
baguette.
At least. But she does teach them how to have sex, and, you know, so anyway, so yeah, they're playing with fire kind of fits into that whole sort of subcategory of teacher student movies from that time. Yeah. So what do you think about their playing with fire?
A true classic.
Classy.
My favorite thing about, and it's a wild movie because, like you said, it switches genres. It's like the student teacher movie. It's like a sexy movie. It's a noir. It's a slasher. Like, it's like so many things. My favorite element about this movie is that it has a theme song.
Yes, a good theme song.
And it's played a couple times, so I'm all for that. I watched that one quite a bit as a kid, for obvious reasons. And yeah, Sybil Danning definitely was like very prolific in the 80s and on the in the video store. She not only had movies she starred in, but she hosted movies, like much like Elvira did on video cassette. So yeah. It was called Sybil Danning's Adventure Video or some whatever it was.
Yeah.
I just remember the big boxes with Sybil Danning featured very prominently. And yes.
Yeah, I don't know what I was a young gay kid. I mean, I wasn't into, like, you know, the big boobs and all that stuff, but she had just such a weird affect. Like, she was really sultry and sexy, but at the same time, kind of flat. And you know what I mean? Like, the delivery of the affect was a bit flat. And I don't know, like, there was something about her that I found really enigmatic. And I was like, what are all those boobs?
And I think I remember reading somewhere that she was particularly proud of this performance. So that's pretty cool. Also worth noting, this is a remake of the director Howard Avedis. He made a movie in the 70s with Angel Tompkins called The Teacher. This is his remake of it, his own movie.
That's right.
And Howard Avedis went on to make a slasher classic in the early 80s called Mortuary.
Yeah.
Bill Paxton. That's a lot of fun. So I'm a fan of his movies. They have a weird kind of quality to them. This one too.
yeah, it does. Yeah, I mean, this movie, I mean, it's so crazy. And, like, there's, like, a happy ending that sort of reminds me of Jackie Brown, you know? Like, if Robert Forrester had decided to get into the car with Jackie Brown and, like, take off with her. That's kind of what we get with this movie, so.
All right, so that is They're Playing With Fire. My number five here is the DVD trailer.
Meet Poppy.
Have you ever had a driving lesson before?
Yeah. No. Wasn't really a lesson.
She's cheerful.
Hello.
Positive.
Cheers.
Carefree.
How's your love life? How is my love life? You okay with that?
Oh, yeah.
But not everyone in her life...
What is the passions? What is the blood? This is flamenco.
...is as happy-go-lucky.
Come on! Drive the car! You're not driving a camel!
Incredible to think I'm going to get even bigger. All right, there's no need to rub it in.
From Miramax Films comes a film by Mike Lee...
You can't take life seriously, Poppy.
You've got to be joking. I just want you to be happy, that's all.
I am happy. I love my life.
I've got a great job, amazing friends.
Yeah, it can be tough at times, that's part of it.
Discover the film festival sensation.
Are you happy in your life?
That's a big question.
Isn't it, Jess?
That shows how seeing the world through Poppy's eyes can change the way you look at life.
You know, you can make jokes while you're driving, but you will crash and you will die laughing.
Well, if you're gonna go, that's the best way to go, I suppose.
Dancing like this goes, eating cheese on toast. Yeah, you made me merry, made me very, very happy, but you obviously, you didn't want to stick around.
Have a good day.
You can't make everyone happy.
There's no harm in trying, though, is there?
Happy-go-lucky.
That is awfully disgusting. Oh,
chicken fillets.
Lunch, anyone? Oh, hello?
Okay, that's the trailer for Happy-Go-Lucky from 2008. This film stars Sally Hawkins in an award-nominated performance. Here, Sally Hawkins plays a primary school teacher in I believe in London, who it really traces her life at the time. And there are a few scenes in school, but really a lot of the movie is outside of the school, and just like her relationships, and her friendships, her learning to drive. There's a lot of this movie is about there's a series of vignettes in this movie, and I like a lot of them in it. I'm not usually a big fan of movies that just kind of have like vignettes, but Mike Lee's really good at doing that, and incorporating him well into the film. And I feel like a lot of the vignettes in this film kind of center around kind of learning something about learning, right? Taking like her being a teacher, but also learning to drive. And there's several of them in this movie. And I just think this movie kind of, when I saw it at the Sunshine Cinema, and it just kind of caught me by surprise. I had seen some Mike Lee films before, but this one was very sunny and light. It has some serious beats to it, but it's mostly a comedy. And I found myself laughing at the Poppy character. I think she's just quite special and really funny in this movie. I think she's just the kind of character who just kind of is very cheery all the time, but you know there's a sadness underneath it all, because like, it's like a she's kind of covering up her cheeriness, her sadness with cheeriness. And the movie gets to the heart of that, but also always remains light and airy, and you just kind of trace her and her friendships and her possible relationship. And it does it in such a way that I just love. I went back to this one recently, and like I found myself feeling like I just had a wide smile on my face the whole time, really. And it kind of left me with that. And I'm just really happy that this movie exists. Sally Hawkins is a person that I actually got to know a little bit while working on a movie.
Really?
And, you know, we just were friendly, and she was so nice and so like much like her Poppy character, just wow. a ray of sunshine and warmth, and in real life as well as she is on film. And I just adore her and this movie. How about for you?
I am so happy you chose Happy Go Lucky. I love this movie. I love it so much. Sally Hawkins is a model human being in this movie. She mm-hmm. is the person I wake up every day and I want to be her. You know, I mean, she is, I mean, you're right. There's a lightness and an airiness about it, but there's also kind of a seriousness and sadness to it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, she's basically the kind of person who's just, you know, she's made the decision that she's going to try to embrace the best of life, embrace people, embrace every opportunity that comes her way, you know, and just like be a good person. And even if she comes across somebody who isn't a good person, like the driving instructor, mm-hmm. you know, she will, you know, she'll do what she can to sort of, you know, try and bring that person out, I guess, or try to make them a little bit happy. But at the same time, she's not stupid or naive. She has her limits. And mm-hmm. like that relationship with the driving teacher, I mean, he pushes her. And yeah. at a certain point, she's like, nope, sorry, this isn't good for me. I need to leave you. And I really like that complexity to her character, because at a certain point you do watch this movie and there's like people bumping up against her on the bus and she just smiles and you're like, mm-hmm. who is this crazy woman? You know, who would do that? But you realize that there's like a lot of depth to her. Mm-hmm. And
right.
Yeah. And you're right. There's sadness too. There's that really interesting scene where she talks with the homeless guy and he's yeah. just speaking complete nonsense, but she's so sweet. Like, he keeps saying, do you know what I mean? Do you know what I mean? And of course he doesn't mean anything, but she keeps saying, yeah, I get it. I know what mm-hmm. you're talking about. And it's just like really a generous, kind person. So
mm-hmm.
yeah, I love Happy Go Lucky. I saw it when it came out. I don't think I've seen it since. And so it was really nice to go back and revisit this. And thank you for making me look bad, because we've just gone from They're Playing with Fire to Happy Go Lucky.
And this all... Sorry about that. The element that this had in common with your original number five was that she's also taking dance lessons Yeah. Like that movie, I'm sorry, Stepping Out. So she's taking flamenco lessons, which is fun. I like seeing those scenes too. Like seeing her try to get approval from the very kind of strict flamenco teacher.
Yeah.
It's definitely a movie about learning.
For sure. And you see her learning. And also, I like the scenes where she has a kid who's bullying another kid, and she has to intervene and figure out, like, what's the deal with this boy? So she contacts a social service person and they come. And I really like the dynamic of watching her sort of step in and do all of that kind of like teacher business, you know, yeah. managing students and stuff like that. It's really well done.
Very heartfelt. So it came out November 21st, 2008. It made $3.5 million at the box office. You know, it was an art house kind of movie. Ended up making $18.6 million worldwide. Like I said, I saw it at the Sunshine Cinema in New York City. Playing at the time, just to give you an idea of the time period, 2008. At this time, these movies were playing. Let the Right One In, Slumdog Millionaire, Vicky Cristina Barcelona, Tell No One, JCVD, Repo Man, The Genetic Opera, Rock and Rolla, Twilight, Quantum of Solace, Role Models, Zack and Miri, Changeling, not The Changeling, but Changeling, Rachel Getting Married, A Christmas Tale, Schenectady, New York, Man on Wire, W, Body of Lies, Saw 5, High School Musical 3, Nick and Nora's Infinite Playlist, Burn After Reading, Bolt, The Haunting of Molly Hartley, Pride and Glory, Max Payne, and The Secret Life of Bees. There are quite a few titles in there that I think time has forgotten already, just to give you an idea of the 2000s.
Yeah. God, you know, it's so funny hearing you say all of that. I mean, it kind of seems like that was just yesterday, but also mm-hmm. that does seem like it was a long time ago.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's hear your number four. Let's play the team spot.
Class of 1984, their only goal is power.
I run this school, man. If you want to survive around here, you have got to learn to look the other way.
I am the future.
Somebody's got to stop this insanity.
If they are the future, who will stop them? Class of 1984, rated R.
Opening next Friday at a theater or drive-in near you.
Well, in 1984, the straight boys had Professor Danning, and gay boys like me had Perry King. And that is why I loved Class of 1984 when I was a kid. I think for a lot of gay boys, like Perry King has, especially like Gen X gay boys, Perry King has a special place in our hearts because I don't know if you remember the show he was on, Riptide.
Yeah, I remember.
It was like a buddy cop show.
Mustache, maybe?
Yeah, mustache. Yep. And also there's like a split second in the opening credits where you see him running in his underwear. And I cannot tell you how many gay guys my age have like cited this as a formative moment in TV history for them. But also, you know, like Andy Warhol's Bad. And then he did that really weird movie with Meg Foster.
A different story
where like he plays a gay guy who ends up with a lesbian, which mm-hmm. is weird. But
I do like that movie, but yeah, it's a little odd. It's an oddball movie.
Yeah. So yeah, he had all there was all of this other like gay stuff surrounding him. And then of course, like Roddy McDowell, who always read gay to me. And I kind of always had a little bit of a crush on Roddy McDowell. He never publicly came out, but I think for me, like my entrance into Class of 1984, which is this classic movie now, it was all of that kind of like gay stuff, the subtext that was in the background. Yeah, I mean, I don't need to say a lot about this movie. I think it's pretty universally beloved, probably especially by people who listen to this podcast. So I just want to say a few things about what I like so much about the movie. I mean, sometimes you've just got to kill to teach, right? You know?
True.
Like that's the true. Yeah. If you want to play Moon River in your class, you just got to, you know, whip the kids into shape. But I I really like Perry King in this movie. He's absolutely gorgeous with his neatly groomed beard and his suit. And I'm sorry, if Perry King tells you to like shut up, you just shut up. You know, you shut up and you look at him teach. you don't misbehave in his class. He's too hot. I really love Roddy McDowall. I mean, he plays that teacher you never want to become, you know, completely disillusioned, disenchanted, an alcoholic who's forced to give lectures at gunpoint. if you've reached that point in your teaching career, things have gone very, very badly. And then, of course, like the gang, you know, I don't know what this gang is, solid gold dancers, Vivian Westwood models, but the outfits are off the hook. You know, they're wearing like chains and, you know, all kinds of crazy things. Especially Timothy Van Patten, who plays the leader of the gang. He's so pretty, by the way, with his like Fidel Sassoon hair. and speaking of hair, Michael J. Fox's hair is worth noting. Very nice hair. And then, of course, is that like amazing final showdown where Perry King goes totally Bronson on the gang, you know, and he's, he's doing things in this movie that I think are so wild, like, you know, using metal objects to, you know, kill students, sawing arms off of kids, you know. But I don't know. Despite all of the, like, it's so over the top and so sort of operatic, but beneath, I think, all of that, there's a really genuine pathos about teachers really wanting to teach and, you know, they're up against all the odds. And it's a movie that definitely stayed with me. So I don't know, what do you think about Class of 1984?
Oh yeah, I've talked about this one before in the podcast. I love this movie. It holds up well too, surprisingly, even though it's a movie definitely of its time and a reactionary movie to its time, where crime was pretty high in the 80s and certainly movies were reflecting that. And this is the Death Wish, you know, movie, like sequel era. And it feels like that. It feels very much of that canon. But take instead of like a Bronson, you have someone who plays it more real, like Perry King as a normal teacher put in extraordinary circumstances of a school that's just, how can anyone learn? And how can anyone get anything away from this, you know, from this experience? Because of these gangs and because of the anarchy that's really going on. And he does try to, he's new at the school and he tries to help and clean up, but it's not, it definitely goes south from pretty quick. And he finds himself in a face-off with these guys. And that's what I love about this movie, because it goes there, you know, it doesn't pull any punches. It's going to be pretty grisly and exploitation-y, and I enjoy that about this movie. It really does do that, and it packs a punch. It's, you know, it's pretty affecting movie, and it's something that always stayed with me, seeing it pretty young and as an adult. And I really think Perry King is good to watch. I think he's great in his roles. He did a few of these movies in the 80s, I remember. Another one, a gritty kind of slashery movie called The Visiting Hour, right? Hour? Yeah. And he just he kind of plays a character in that it's quite surprising. I think there were quite a few, and I just really like him in this movie. I think really Roddy McDowall is so much fun to watch this movie. You really feel for him when his when a certain thing happens to his his beloved animals, and it's quite crazy. Mark L. Lester, the director, is really good at making all kinds of genre movies, and
yeah, for sure,
he made Roller Boogie, he made this, he made Commando, like all kinds, and he even did a sequel to this movie, or kind of a remake. Sequel/remake, called Class of 1999, which I talked about on this podcast.
And I have to say, I love that movie too. That movie is really, really, I hadn't seen it since, I don't know, a long time. And I just watched it for the podcast. And it is so much fun watching, you know, these crazy militaristic robot teachers, you know, go around shooting students.
Yes.
Yeah, and that's a fun movie.
And they're quite fun to watch in that movie. I think they, those teachers, I mean, having like the cast that it has alone, I really feel like is worth watching Class of 1999.
For
seeing
sure.
Those teachers, seeing Stacy Keach and Pam Grier and a few other people in that movie pop up.
Stacy Keach with his crazy eyes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Have you seen the sequel to Class of 1999, by the way?
I haven't seen the sequel to that, no.
Yeah, there's a part two. I haven't seen it either.
I haven't seen that. I need to get on it. Since I like these two movies so much. Yeah, I'm a big fan. I'm a real big fan of it. So I'm glad you picked it because I probably would have. But I think I've talked about it
so good.
Before. So
I'll yeah. Now.
here's a TV spot for my number four.
Writer Grady Tripp.
So how's the book?
Don't touch it.
The worst day of his life is about to become...
I just got my hood jumped on.
The best thing that ever happened to him.
I'm pregnant.
Hello?
Academy Award winner Michael Douglas.
I'm in love with your wife.
Academy Award winner Frances McDormand.
You didn't call our house last night, did you?
I think I might have, yes.
From the director of L.A. Confidential.
I love you, Grady.
Wonder Boys, rated R. Starts Friday, February 25th in theaters everywhere.
Okay, that's Wonder Boys, starring Michael Douglas as a professor in Pittsburgh University. Okay, I don't remember which one it is, but I don't think it matters. So it kind of traces his life, being a middle-aged professor where his wife is leaving him, and he has a book that's very overdue that he's writing. It's quite an epic that he's working on, and he's kind of stuck. He has a student played by Tobey Maguire, who's quite unusual. He has his own issues, so kind of traces the teacher and a student and the kind of the craziness that happens over I don't know how long it is of the stretch. I feel like it's not a very long period of time. It's like a few days maybe. And I'll call it the wacky craziness that happens, and it kind of deals with his writer's block. It deals with the students' issues, and then his editor, played by Robert Downey Jr. coming. Remember when Robert Downey Jr. was good in movies, and he would show up?
Oh yes,
yeah. And then like he has another student played by Katie Holmes who kind of lives with him. And then Frances McDormand playing, I think she's another teacher or a professor or is she a dean?
He's the wife of the chancellor.
The wife of the chancellor. Right?
Yeah.
That he's having a relationship with. So it kind of has all these balls juggling. This movie and his character is juggling these balls, and you could quite see that he's not up for everything. He's constantly smoking pot to deal with a lot of the stress that he's under, and he's just he guess he's under a lot of strain and pressure to finish this novel, and he's stuck. And so this is a movie about a character in that time of his life where he finds himself in that state and what can happen when all these other kind of characters kind of come into the scene and kind of mix things up for him. And it's kind of, the movie is kind of chaotic at times, but in a very entertaining way. And I just remember when this came out, being quite surprised by it and thinking it was really well done, directed by Curtis Hanson, of course made LA Confidential, but more importantly made The Hand That Rocks the Cradle. Mm-hmm. And some really fun thrillers. So I'm a big fan of Curtis Hanson and his thrillers. And I think he does a really good job here. And it did okay when it came out. I think there were definitely some good notices for the movie, but I think I feel like over time, maybe slightly not forgotten, but maybe not as well remembered. But I feel like hopefully it has its fans still, and I'm sure they're out there. It came out at a weird time. I remember coming out like in February when it should have been more of a like an autumn release because it was a very cold, chilly autumny kind of movie, and I think maybe I would have gotten some more awards recognition. Certainly deserved it. Yeah.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. I remember when this movie came out. I didn't see it, and I'll explain why. But yeah, I think I actually forgot about this movie as well. And I think maybe that was part of the reason. And it's funny because you're right. It does feel very autumnal. Like the colors are gold and red. And, you know, I don't know why they would have released this movie in February. But I'm really glad you chose this movie because when it came out, I remember thinking, this is not a movie for me. Like in 2000, I was not really, I wasn't really ready for this movie because I just didn't want to see a movie about like middle-aged people having middle-aged problems. That didn't seem so interesting to me at that time in my life. And so I had never seen it until I watched it for this podcast. And I'm really glad that I waited because I don't think I would have liked it then, but now at my age, I do like it. Not because I see myself in these characters, but I can certainly see people I know. I guess I can see aspects of myself. Just like being, you know, in your middle age, you know, and trying to sort of still figure things out. You know, it's like, I guess when you're younger, you sort of think, you know, you're on this one really clear path and you're just going to keep going down that path. But, you know, life takes twists and turns and, you know, you end up going to places that you never thought you would go, like France, for example. I feel like this is a movie that's sort of dealing with that and just how you kind of wake up one day at middle age and you think, oh, okay, that's not what I was expecting things to be, but that's what it is. So just get on with it. I like this movie. I don't know, for some reason, it reminds me of like a John Irving novel. I'm a big John Irving fan. Right. It has a kind of similar structure. It's very loose, lots of different characters, lots of sort of crazy situations happening. I like this movie. I like the performances. I thought Frances McDormand was really good. She's doing her Frances McDormand thing. But at that time, it was still sort of fresh. Not that I dislike, but I do like Frances McDormand. I like her a lot. But back then, there was a different kind of energy to it because, you know, you weren't so used to seeing it. And also, Robert Downey Jr., I know what you're talking about. I think he was on drugs. I'm glad he's off of the drugs. But the performances were so good.
He was so interesting.
pre-MCU Robert Downey Jr. I don't know. Oh well, there's this interesting character. There's a cross-dresser character in this movie. I think Tony. And I was really curious to know how at that time how they would handle a character like this. At first, I was a little bit annoyed because, of course, you see this massive cross-dresser character. I mean, I'm not even sure if she's trans, if she's a drag queen. I don't know. But everybody's staring and you expect at any moment, you know, this poor person is going to become the butt of a joke or something. But the movie takes this really interesting turn. They give they give the person dignity, you know, and they show, you know, and nothing but respect. And Michael Douglas is totally cool. They get into a car together. He's totally cool with the person. And, you know, it's not a big deal. And Robert Downey Jr. is, I don't know, experimenting or he's interested in cross-dressers or something. I don't know. But all of this is handled like so well. And I'm surprised to see that from a movie from that time.
I agree. That's definitely something that was nice. Like it pays off really nicely.
It does.
A lot of the characters. This is a Michael Chabon novel, but adapted by Steve Kloves, who did one of my favorites from the late 80s, The Fabulous Baker Boys. And he did a good job with adapting the book, which I read as well. All right. Let's take a break and we'll be back right after this.
You're playing with fire, Jane.
What do you do when the only sound is the beat of your heart, tearing you apart with its pounding. Where do you go? Can't you run away from a love that is wrong, but the feeling's so strong that you stay. There's no looking ahead. Live for now instead, 'cause you're flying, and you know you shouldn't stay, and you said you wouldn't stay, but love's taking you higher, higher, higher. Oh, you're playing with fire.
And we're back. Hope you enjoyed that. Here is a trailer for your number three, Daniel.
It's the rhythm of romance. It's the danger of desire. A teacher, his student, and the dance that changed their lives and tore a school apart.
You're fired.
Exotic, erotic, lose yourself in the heat.
This is the 90s, man. Chicks got a right to choose.
Go all the way. Lambada. Set the night on fire.
Lambada. So I don't know why. I don't know why movie execs thought Lambada needed to be paired up with some kind of like social cause. I mean, we got The Forbidden Dance, which was really a movie about saving the rainforest. Mm-hmm. Right. Now with Lambada, we get a movie about a teacher just wanting to teach and to do well by inner city students trying to get their GED. And along the way, do a lot of dancing. Yeah, so this is such, talk about ridiculous movies. I love this movie. I just want to give a little bit of context. So I did see this movie when it came out and then instantly forgot about it. There was nothing memorable to me about Lambada. But then about 12 years ago, I was still undergoing the tenure review process at my college. And I had a colleague who was also undergoing the same tenure review process. And one day she came to school with a DVD of Lambada. And she was, it was like contraband. She said, you know, when I was a girl, I thought this was the sexiest, steamiest movie. And I, it was like the hottest thing she'd ever seen. And I was like, give me that DVD. I need to watch this movie again. And instantly, it was like re-seeing Lambada with fresh eyes. And then I think we somehow ended up passing this DVD around to other teachers, but it was all very like on the down low because no respectable teacher wants to be seen with Lambada. But now I don't really care. So Lambada stars J. Eddie Peck. Is that his name? I don't really know this actor, who plays this teacher with this really sort of amazing backstory. He was adopted from Mexico, and apparently he grew up a greaser, although, I mean, greasers weren't really a thing like in the 70s or 80s, unless you were on Sha Na Na. But I hope everybody knows who Sha Na Na is. Otherwise,
look it up. Google search.
Look it up. Yeah. But then, like, I guess he turned his life around. He married a nice wife and he got himself this teaching position at a fancy prep school for 25-year-old teenagers, including Melora Harding, who plays Sandy. Melora Harding, who I know from The Office and also from Transparent, but I know she's done a lot of other things.
Soul Man,
yeah. And oh boy, does she have it hot for teacher. She's no Eric Brown and they're playing with fire, but you know, this one, she's sitting in class like chewing on her pencil. She's got that look in her eyes, like, you know, take me, staring at J. Eddie Peck. And one night she ends up going to a club where she sees him dancing. And this is one of my favorite moments in all of cinema. So he walks into this club, right? And he tells the doorman, okay, I've got time for one dance tonight. Not that anybody has asked. You know, it's as if, you know, he's doing this club a favor by coming in and doing a dance. And then he goes out to the dance floor and like all the women are sort of swarming around him saying, oh, dance with me, dance with me. And he's like, no, I can't. And then he's like, okay, one dance. He rips that leather jacket off of his body, throws it on the ground, grabs a girl and just like starts grinding on the dance floor with her. And the whole time his student Sandy is watching him, and she asks her friend, oh, what is that dance he's doing? Yeah, this is supposed to be like a hot, sultry scene. And, you know, meanwhile, everybody else in the club is doing like perfectly choreographed dance moves. I've never been to a dance club like this, but apparently that's what they do at this club. So for anybody who hasn't seen the movie, that just gives you a general idea of the crazy ridiculousness of it. There's a lot more I can say, but I'll pass it on to you. What do you want to add about
Lumbada? Oh my God, Lumbada is like the best movie ever made. That's my review. I mean, it doesn't get any better than this movie. Watch this movie, guys, and you will learn much about life. You will learn all you need to know about life by watching Lumbada, student-teacher relationships, dancing in clubs, but also taking responsibility by putting back into the world by teaching unfortunate, you know, kids who just, I guess they skipped out on school to dance. So now they need to learn something.
He teaches them how to use a protractor at a pool table.
Yeah. He gives them many skills, life skills that are important. And all the while maintaining a perfect hair and this dual life of, which apparently his wife approves of. He has a wife at home, and she knows.
Poor lady.
She's a very sad character. She's always home watching him like get ready for school. I don't know, what does she do? Like she just sits at home and waits for him.
He's
going out at night dancing and then teaching kids.
Well, you know what he tells her? He just leaves her at home with the baby, and he says, sorry, you knew what you were getting when you signed up for this package.
Right.
And then he walks out, he leaves his wife, and her only role in life is to like look at him like starry-eyed and just be supportive. And that's it.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, the club scenes are amazing. The just the look of them, like just there's so much going on. There's like a literal cop car, like that's used as a lighting fixture on the ceiling. Amazing. There's so much to look at. The music, the scenes, many, many set pieces in this movie, like a scene in computer class. The scene in computer class has to be seen. You can watch it on YouTube, guys, if you need a taste of Lombada.
So good.
So this is the rich kids' school. They're in computer class and they're learning. And the nerdy guy, the very stereotypically nerdy guy, does a program where the computer does it, is dancing. And yeah, it leads to them doing a very choreographed dance scene in class, along with kind of like the jerky villain guy. It's just a marvel to watch. Every scene,
and then we get that great quiz off at the end with like the inner city kid. Oh, Galaxy High. You know what he does? He creates like an underground high school for GED students called Galaxy High,
yep.
And he gambles to get money to buy them T-shirts.
Yes. Going far and away. Yeah, he's going above and beyond his duties as a teacher.
Yeah. And that quiz off, huh? That's crazy. They're just like doing math problems.
Yes. You know? it's quite amazing. I mean, every scene in this movie is amazing. I could watch this movie over and over, honestly, and be entertained by it because it just is. Melora Hardin as the student who kind of has this short kind of haircut, who kind of resembles, she just resembles a lot of people. She kind of plays a similar role in Soul Man, where she falls for the guy and goes out of her way to get this guy, and that's she does that with, of course, C. Thomas Howell, but sadly blackface.
It's unfortunate.
That's not gonna hold up that well. And then she introduces him to her parents, and you know, she's kind of similar in that movie. In this movie, she's kind of head over heels with this guy, and you know, it's very icky moments of like her creatively trying to like get a piece of J. Eddie Peck. Scenes where
she
sneaks
into
him.
His car. She sneaks into his car, grabs his dick, and
yes.
What?
And of course, like on the motorcycle with him, and
yes.
a lot of questionable stuff. But then she learns by the end of the movie that it's just a crush.
Yeah.
And you know, he's not, I guess he skirts that line where he knows she's really infatuated him, but he doesn't, you know, do the right thing. I mean, where he's, he's telling her to get away from him, but he's not, you know, he's not doing it enough.
Yeah.
So it takes
and then
a
I
home,
love it. They have her save the day because he loses his job, right, from the prep school. So she rallies like all of East LA to come to the prep school and like save him so he can get his job back.
Yeah, she learns that. She learns some hard lessons about love and that you have to kind of put that aside sometimes to help others. Yes. There's so much to learn in Lombada. Lombada is really, yeah. Of course, there were the two Lombada movies, like we mentioned, The Forbidden Dance. They both were competing to come out before each other, and they ended up coming out on the same day. This is definitely the better movie. This is the canon movie. So all of canon goodness is here on display. I love it.
Yeah. So which one did you go and see?
I saw this one.
Yeah.
This is the one that, I knew it was going to be better, and I'm glad it was.
Yep.
All right. Here is a trailer for my number 3.
At a one-room schoolhouse in the Australian outback on a not-quite-ordinary day, 9 children and a teacher began to learn the lesson they would remember the rest of their lives.
They're going on a picnic.
A teacher and 9 children stalked by terror.
You know how to catch a rabbit?
No, sir.
See, rabbits can't look straight ahead. So you come up on him from his blind spot, which is head on.
We've got to fight them! We outnumber them 4-1!
Can the tools of childhood be forged into weapons? Can courage build a fortress? Fortress, a lesson in survival.
Okay, that's Fortress, starring Rachel Ward as a teacher in the Australian outback. And one day, while teaching her kids, this group of men, it's like three of them, kidnap them and take them like deep into the outback and terrorize them. And we're not sure why. The movie never really gets into why, but it's all about them stuck in the situation, a teacher and her students, and how do they get out of it? And for a lot of the movie, they're like trapped in a cave, and then the cave leads to other things. And really, this movie, when I saw this, it was an HBO cable premiere movie. So premiered on cable in 85. I was there. I watched it. It was right. It premiered like Thanksgiving weekend. what better movie to watch for your entire family around Thanksgiving than a movie about a teacher and her students trying to survive at all odds in the Australian outback? And I didn't really, I guess I knew it was sort of like a different place, but it felt like it could have been anywhere to me, like could have been the United States. It could have been somewhere rural. So I didn't get hung up on the fact that I was in Australia, whatever. Because I guess there's that sometimes when you're younger, it's like, oh, you know, this is another place. It doesn't mean as much to me, right? Like if it's like a foreign movie, for example, when you're that young, because I was 10. But it felt like it could be in the United States. It felt like it could have been rural, like USA. And it really scared me, this movie, as a kid watching.
No
this.
Kidding.
It was terrifying. I mean,
so I know
traces all those things that they need to do to be able to get out of a situation. And then you really see Rachel Ward as a teacher, but as a person really doing whatever she can to help them. And she's quite resourceful. There's booby traps. There's it takes swimming skills. There's lots of elements in this movie that she utilizes to help these kids. And yes, it could get tedious or a little annoying with some of the kids, but it's quite thrilling at the same time. And I really, when I rewatched this movie recently, I watched it with Joyce and we just got really into it.
It's so good. It goes to some
pretty crazy places and dark places by the end, but also thrilling. I was really behind it. I wasn't quite as scared this time. I'm not a kid anymore. So I wasn't quite seeing it from the kid's point of view anymore. More the teacher's point of view and how she would get out of this, what she does to get out of it. I was kind of just thrilled by that. Yeah. And I just think that's, it's really effective. And this movie just needs to be seen more.
No, seriously.
Your first time seeing it, I think, right?
It is. I mean, I have to just say, so, you know, Wolf's Creek, Picnic at Hanging Rock, Fortress, I don't want anything to do with the Australian outback. There's some crazy shit, people doing weird things out there. So I actually do get a little bit hung up on the location. But yeah, this was my first time seeing this movie. And I mean, I wrote down Goonies, Deliverance, Wolf Creek, Rambo, Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome, Teacher Savior Movie. Like, yeah. It's all of those things. And Rachel Ward is great. I mean, Teacher of the Year, you know, she is looking for those teachable moments and she's finding, like, yes, the best teacher. You know, she's teaching them how to dress shotgun wounds, how to open cans of beans with knives, you know, how to set booby traps. And the whole time she's totally like calm, collected. She's got this great attitude. Like, you know, this happens every school year, you know? And she's like, come on kids, let's have a story. Let's have a song, you know, while they're being thrown into a van or a cave.
Right.
And then, you know, they're in the cave, right? They get shoved into this dark cave. There's no light. And she's like, okay, kids, let's use our brains. What should we do? And then she goes like full on MacGyver and she teaches them how to make a lamp with a can and like a string or something.
Mm-hmm. Like shoelaces, right? Yeah.
Shoelace. And then the second half, you're right. It gets kind of scary and intense. Like when they chase them, or no, they go to the old people's house, elderly couple's house. And then, you know, they have to like escape the kidnappers and create these, you know, this elaborate fortress with all of these weapons and booby traps and things like that.
Yeah.
It does get pretty scary. So
yeah,
I could see why you would have been afraid when you were a child.
And also the you never see their faces. They're always wearing masks or their heads are out of frame. So that's what kind of adds to it, because it could be anybody, right?
Yeah, they're wearing crazy, like a fox, and I think Santa Claus, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Father Christmas, I think they call him or something. Yeah,
Father Christmas. And then the end of this movie gets really crazy, you know? Like, so it's, I guess, the next day, and they're all back at school, and Rachel Ward is reading them a book from a book, and then some inspectors come and start questioning them, and... These kids are like, you better stop asking us questions if you know what's good for you.
Right.
Pan to a shot of like body, disembodied, you know, body parts and jars, things like that. These kids, they've been chopping up body parts, you know, it's crazy.
That reveal is nuts, guys. It implies like a lot of like, whoa, when you think about what it implies, like, oh, this is a secret they're going to keep. Oh my God.
But you're right. One of the weird things about the movie, I guess it's kind of jarring. Like, why are they kidnapping this teacher and her kids? I mean, there's no reason. Surely there can't be that much money, you know, for a hostage and kidnapping a teacher. But
yeah, it's not explained. But I think maybe that's what makes it scary. Like, you don't know what their intentions are, what's going to happen to them. You're just like, yeah, you're just kind of kidnapped with them in a way. And that's kind of what the movie wisely does. And it, you're just kind of, and I also like that her character is so strong, because, you know, if she's like breaking down, these kids are going to feel really fucked, man. Like, if your teacher like can't deal with this, like, how are you going to like get out of this, right? So yeah, it's a really good performance by Rachel Ward, who, you know, got a lot of, I guess, flack, you know, for like some of her performances back then, but I think she's really strong here.
Yeah, she's great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I love this movie.
Yeah. It's a gem of a movie. Hopefully it'll get a Blu-ray release. There's an out of print, I think, HBO DVD that I have. It's probably, I think it's streaming on, I think it might be on YouTube. Okay. So just give you an idea what was playing on TV at the same time, at the same day. Silver Spoons, the Barber Mandrell Thanksgiving special. the movie Sparkle was playing. Punky Brewster, Ripley's Believe It or Not. Dress to Kill was playing on TV. 10 to Midnight was playing on TV. Murder, She Wrote, Amazing Stories, Star Search, The Ewoks, Battle for Endor, Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous.
Wow.
Paris, Texas, Sudden Impact, Alfred Hitchcock Presents, something called Double Take, Mussolini, The Untold Story, Masterpiece Theater, Last Place on Earth, Take a Letter, Darling, The Prisoner, Yentl, Rich Little, SCTV, and the Martin Short Concert for the North Americas was playing this
I missed that.
Thanksgiving time. So you had a lot to watch, but HBO's Fortress would have been the most memorable. Let's get into your number two. Here it is.
In class, he's just another face in the crowd. In heaven, the hottest dance club in town. He's the main attraction. When the feeling hit them, there was no place hotter than heaven. A Night in Heaven. Rated R. Starts Friday, November 18th at a selected theater near you.
A Night in Heaven, aka A Night in Christopher Atkins' Pants, aka Florida people doing Florida things. Oh my God, what is there to say about A Night in Heaven? First up, how did this movie get made? Mm-hmm. How did this happen? John G. Appleton, I mean, Rocky, Karate Kid, Lean on Me, Joan Tewkesbury, Nashville, and then NASA signed off on this? I don't understand. Like, what was NASA thinking in the 80s that they had, like, such a terrible image problem. They needed to, you know, get sexier. They're like, get us that Blue Lagoon kid, you know, get us a janitor who will pop and lock while he's waxing the floors at Cape Canaveral. Next stop, Space Camp with Kate Capshaw, right? Yeah, this movie, it's a crazy, crazy movie. Our teacher here is obviously the beautiful, fabulous, and I think totally underrated Leslie Ann Warren. I love her in everything, and she holds this movie together. I don't know, somehow, like, there's a through line with Leslie Ann Warren being so consistent and so dedicated to her role as Faye. This very kind of repressed, sort of uptight speech teacher who has very questionable taste in men. Clearly, Faye has man problems. So we first see Faye teaching. She's giving, it's like the last day of school or something. She's giving oral speech lessons. And lucky her, Christopher Atkins is one of her students. And, you know, he gives his oral speech and he does it totally, you know, he's like fine. I mean, it's not brilliant, but, you know, he's not failing. And then he sits down immediately after and makes one stupid joke. And she's so uptight. She's like, you're not serious. You've got nothing to say. You're failing this class, you know? And her reaction is very strange, but obviously she's a bit flustered and, you know, I guess sort of we're meant to think that she's repressing sexual feelings for him. And coincidentally, she goes to a club with her friends and lo and behold, Christopher Atkins is a stripper at this club. He's stripping under the name of Ricky Rocket. And he's dressed up because this is a NASA movie as a spaceman. I mean, he does look like Neil Armstrong, but you know, he's wearing like a full space suit.
Maybe that was NASA's like note on the script. Okay, we like the script, but can you make him a spaceman?
Just not too Neil Armstrong-y. You don't want and so they see each other in the audience, they connect. Long story short, they end up having this, you know, they end up having one night in heaven, if you will.
hell.
Well, that's the thing. This movie takes the cross-cutting in this movie is so insane. So Faye has got this husband at home who's an out of work. I don't know. He works at Cape Canaveral. I don't know if he's an astronaut or he's some kind of a scientist.
He's like a designer, right? He designs things. Like, he's designing a bicycle. He designs that bicycle, right? That weird bicycle thing. So maybe that's he designs other things at NASA. He's a NASA designer. Let's call him that.
Yeah, NASA designer. Yeah. He's on the NASA design team. And anyway, every time you see him, like the movie, like progressively plays this very like dark and brooding music as you see him sitting at a kitchen table, like fingering a gun or, you know, something like, you don't know where this movie is going. And then towards the end, it looks like you never really see it, but it's suggested, I guess, that he's having an affair with somebody that he used to work with. And by the end of it, you know, you've got him throwing Christopher Atkins crying naked onto a boat, you know, at gunpoint, and Christopher Atkins is begging for his life, and the guy's like, oh, don't worry about it, I'm not crazy, you know, like this was his twisted revenge against, you know, Christopher Atkins for having an affair with his wife. Anyway, like I said, it's Florida, you know.
I like when Christopher Atkins is like, what about my clothes, he says in a very like, kind of whiny voice. Shrill voice, yeah.
So One Night, what do you think about One Night in Heaven?
Absolutely love One Night in Heaven. I've watched this one a bunch. It's really entertaining. I mean, it's an easy watch because
it has
a lot going on in it, but it's like a very like short movie. It's like 80 something minutes long. It's really short, so it goes by in a breeze, but it's packed with like a lot of fun stuff. I mean, like you, I'm a huge fan of Leslie Ann Warren. I mean, she was definitely an early crush for me. I mean, I would I probably had I'm sure I had a crush on her when I saw this in 83. So yeah, I really liked her a lot, and she's just great. I mean, yeah, she's great. I mean, she's definitely, to me, one of the best things about the movie. You know, there's so many good things about this movie. Questionable things too, but good things. All the same. Yeah, I like her relationship with her, is it her sister? Or is it her friend?
Patsy.
Patsy, yeah. Deborah Rush is great in this movie. I think she needs some notice. I think she's great. And she has her own life back somewhere, and she's just kind of just trying to escape it. And yeah, this movie about, yes, again, another middle-aged movie about people in middle age, and they have these problems, or they feel stuck and they need to get to the next point, or just want to get over something. And it's done in this kind of framework of a going to a stripper club and it's kind of letting go, right? And it goes there with this movie. It does goes there with her, you know, with her and her student. The movie, I guess, goes out of its way to say that he's of legal age, so he's what, 21?
Yeah,
but yeah. He looks younger. And it is questionable, but you know, I get it. He's attractive, and you know, she just wants to feel special again, and yeah, some more power to her.
You know, I speaking of questionable things, so I don't understand the way he breaks off the relationship with her. It's so twisted. So yeah. He, with his girlfriend in the shower, and then he makes her watch, and he makes her catch them in the shower. Yeah, he completely humiliates her. I'm like, what kind of messed up breakup is this?
Yeah. I don't know if that's the kind of thing you want to do with your teacher too. Like, I mean, she's still going to fail him. I mean, she's going to pass him, fail him.
Well, I'll tell you, if any student ever did that to me, I mean,
it's quite an entertaining movie. Just the choreographed scenes of the dancing scenes, the stripper scenes alone, but you got all this other stuff like with the husband and the dark gets into his head. So it gets into a lot of people's heads, right? The wife, the husband, and the friend or sister, whatever she is. There's just a lot going on, and you kind of just kind of along for the ride. And it's just really entertaining. 20th Century Fox on this movie. So now it's Disney's One Night in Heaven. I doubt put it out on Blu-ray anytime soon, which is a shame because it's so entertaining. And yeah, it's a puzzle because it's puzzling because, yeah, directed by John G. Avildsen. I mean,
yeah,
what he chose to do post Rocky movies. His next movie was The Karate Kid.
Didn't we get more sequels to Two Nights in Heaven,
right? Exactly. Yeah, why not?
I'm so big into franchises.
And of course, not a big Bryan Adams fan. But Heaven is the use of Heaven is great in this movie. It's really well done.
Yeah,
it was actually made for this movie.
Was it? I didn't know that. Okay. Yeah, I really love the soundtrack. Is it Jan Hammer? Is that how you say it? Jan Hammer. So, I mean, I guess this movie came out right around the time of Miami Vice. And yeah, I listened to the soundtrack on YouTube all the time because unfortunately this was never released digitally, I guess. It was only released on record and tape. But there are some really good songs on the soundtrack.
Yep. Yeah. I mean, it's a fun movie for many reasons. So
yeah,
hopefully more people will see it. Here is my number two.
It was just another school year. Get to class. Until Boris signed up for Mad Genius 101.
He's a lunatic.
This Nobel Prize winner is teaching Boris things you can't learn from textbooks, like rejuvenating your late wife.
You know, we could go to jail for something like this.
Experimenting with new subjects.
Want to get married?
And making miracles happen for credit.
I can't believe you did it, Harry.
Creator.
Sounds like fun.
Rated R. Starts Friday, September 20th at select theaters.
Okay, that's the TV spot for Creator. This is a 1985 film starring Peter O'Toole, Vincent Spano, Mariel Hemingway, and Virginia Madsen, about a professor. You can kind of call him a mad scientist because he is intent on regrowing using cells and DNA his dead wife. And he enlists the aid of Vincent Spano as this young guy who wants to, I guess he wants to, he's in the school. He knows that this teacher has a reputation, or professor has a reputation for being kind of crazy, but he has a thing for Virginia Madsen's character, who he meets at the school, and he wants to find out more about her. And Peter O'Toole promises that if he comes along to be his research assistant, he'll give him great grades, and he will get her more information about Madsen and her, maybe her phone number or whatever. So it's kind of like that, kind of a wacky setup. And then what he learns with the professor in this case is that yes, he's doing something pretty crazy, but he has a sincere reason to do so. And he kind of gets caught up in that situation, and they find themselves doing something that maybe others don't feel is ethical. And then he does get strike up a relationship with Virginia Madsen, and traces that young love. So you have the young love scenario, and a professor who's pining for his lost love, and then entering the scenario is Mariel Hemingway's character, and she kind of shakes things up for Peter O'Toole. And possibly a romance of sorts blooms there, or at least she is really into Peter O'Toole right away. That's a questionable thing, I guess. Like, this young woman, right, of college age, who has a thing for very quickly for Peter O'Toole. But then you're like, okay, it's fucking Peter O'Toole, so it's like he has a very magnetic quality to him,
right? And it's also Mariel Hemingway, who got together with Woody Allen in Manhattan,
so. Right, so maybe you buy it on that level. I guess I certainly buy it, just because I find everyone so damn charming in this movie. I mean, everyone, the four leads are all great, and something about this movie brings me back to it. I think it's the mix of comedy and genre and drama, but also like the music, the very 80s kind of score. it's a very specific kind of music that I like. I used to think was kind of annoying back in the day, like that kind of very saxy heavy score. But
me
now
too.
I've grown to really like it and miss it in movies.
I know what you mean.
Like stuff like St. Elmo's Fire. There were a lot of those kinds of scores. They're very similar. And this one has it, and it just kind of like makes me feel kind of nostalgic for the time and its setting. I like that it's set in a Northern California school, and it makes the most of the that kind of stuff. But a lot of it's like also the professor's home laboratory, so it's fun seeing those scenes. And and then of course his rivalry with David Ogden Stiers, who initially was going to get Vincent Spano as his student, but then Peter O'Toole steals him away from him. So there's a rivalry there. So traces that rivalry of David Ogden trying to get him kicked out of school, Peter O'Toole, because of his again questionable practices. But I don't know. I find everyone endearing in this movie, and I just picked up the novel on which it's based. I never read it, so I'm curious to read it and just see how much of it is similar. It was directed by Yvonne Passer, who's made some really good movies. I would say in particular Cutter's Way, which is quite a good movie starring Jeff Bridges in the, I think it was came out in the early 80s. So it was probably just before this one movie. So I recommend that movie as well. But I've always been a fan of Creator. How about you?
Well, I had never seen Creator because, for me, like in 1985, right?
Yep.
I remember when this movie came out, I thought this is too grown up for me. And, mm-hmm. Back then, like it seemed like there were like science-y movies all the time. Like My Science Project, and yep. There were tons of like science bait. We were in love with science back then. And to me, like, I wasn't interested in watching like science and romance, and I didn't know who Peter O'Toole was, so it wasn't interesting to me. Watching it for the first time now, I really, really liked it. And I like it for the same reasons you like it. I love the heavy sax. It definitely makes me very nostalgic. And you're right, the chemistry and the charm of the four leads, they're so great to watch and so beautiful. I mean, I've talked about Virginia Madsen on different mm-hmm. podcasts with you. She's one of my favorites from the 80s. I think she's mm-hmm. so gorgeous. Yeah. Vincent Spano is amazing looking. I couldn't believe it. I forgot that he looked like that. And Marielle Hemingway is just like full of energy, and she's very bouncy and sweet. And watching this, like, it made me a little bit sad because I really like Marielle Hemingway, and I wish that she had been able to do a lot more back then.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't know. So yeah, the movie, it was really surprising to me. I guess it's kind of like a mashup of romance and science. And I think I was expecting this to become like a Frankenstein kind of story or something like that. Mm-hmm. But it never really goes that far. They never let Peter O'Toole become that crazy, you know?
Right, yeah.
And I'm with you, the relationship with Marielle Hemingway, right? Mm-hmm. Like, could be her grandfather, but they're happy on the beach together, right, at the end, and you know,
and there aren't any scenes of them like even kissing or anything, which is kind of like she's turned on by his intelligence and his wit, and he's turned on by her charm and just her the way she carries herself. So
yeah,
it's interesting.
And Karen Copens yes, plays his dead wife, who I love. It's always so nice to see her.
She's great.
So there were a lot of surprises in this movie. Good choice. I liked it a lot.
Great. I'm glad you liked it. Came out September 20th, 1985. A low-grossing movie, $5.3 million. I saw it at the Lowe's State Theater. Just so you get an idea what was playing at the time, After Hours, Rambo, Fright Night, Return of the Living Dead, Emerald Forest, Volunteers, Invasion USA, Streetwalkin', Summer Rental, Pritzi's Honor, Desperately Seeking Susan, Maxi, Compromising Positions, Year of the Dragon, Teen Wolf, Cocoon, Sudden Death, Kisser to Spider-Woman, Creature, Marie, American Ninja, The Stuff, Agnes of God, and Silverado. So quite a bit different from the 2000s. You have a lot of gems in there.
Yeah, I saw many of those in the theater. So many gems. I remember.
Yep, same here.
Yeah.
All right. Let's get into our number ones. Here's yours.
What have we learned this year? Teamwork. Sportsmanship. How your friends look naked.
Freddie Shoup got into teaching for the summer's off. But things are about to change.
Well, Mr. Shoup, congratulations. You've been chosen to teach summer school.
No, I'm not a real teacher.
That's all right. These aren't real students.
Please take your seats.
Where should we take them?
Freddie Shoup is teaching summer school. Mark Harmon and Kirstie Alley in a Carl Reiner film.
They're as smart as you and me.
You and I.
All of us.
I love this film. It had passion and a plucky spirit.
Dave, I agree with you. Thumbs up from me.
Same here.
To sum it up, I'm Jansaw.
I'm Dave.
We'll see you at the movies.
You won't see it on HBO or Cinemax. Summer School, exclusively on Showtime. Sunday.
Like I said at the beginning of the podcast, you know, what made me want to be, which teacher maybe want, which movie teacher would I be? For me, it's a mashup of many of the different teachers we've talked about, but probably Shoup. To me, Shoup is the coolest. I love summer school. I don't know. This is a movie. I mean, you talked about how easy it is to watch Creator, which it is. For me, Summer School is one of those movies. It's like Friday the 13th. You know, it's like a warm blanket. I just kind of throw it on me. I can have it on the background. It permanently lives in my head. And it's just, I love the energy. It's so fun. To me, when I watch this movie, it feels like 1987. You know, I grew up in Southern California. So I instantly, you know, recognize, I know what the hairspray smells like. You know, I recognize the clothes, you know, and I don't know, just Shoop, there's something about Shoop. He's so charming and so sweet. And I wouldn't say he's not dumb, but he's a bit naive. I mean, he's not really a teacher. He's a PE teacher. And so suddenly he finds himself stuck with this class. You know, he has to teach English to a bunch of kids who don't really want to be there. And I like the journey he goes on of figuring out how to be a teacher. And I like that he, you know, tries to straighten up and take his job seriously. And just the different relationships he has with the kids, all of whom I think are so, so special. You know, I mean, I love Chainsaw and Denise with her dyslexia, Courtney Thorne Smith, who has a crush on him. And especially his relationship with Kirstie Alley, who never looked more beautiful. I mean, I think Kirstie Alley was probably just starting Cheers when she got this movie. I think it was around that same time. But yeah, she's gorgeous and she's so nice. She plays the next door teacher who, you know, gives him a hand and helps him learn how to be a teacher. And yeah, there's just like lots of really fun moments in this movie, like, you know, watching Texas Chainsaw Massacre in class and scaring off the substitute teacher with this crazy elaborate makeup. And yeah, I don't know. I love the soundtrack. It has Oingo Boingo, which I don't know. I'm a big Oingo Boingo fan. Anybody who grew up in Southern California, I think in the 80s probably is. yeah, it's a fun movie.
Yeah, it's effervescent. It's really fun from beginning to end. Yeah, it's I just I've seen this one many times. I didn't rewatch it for this podcast because I just watched it a few months ago because I just felt like watching it. Right.
Me too.
just because, you know, summer school, yeah. Easy yeah. to watch. streaming right now on HBO Max. I have the, but it also just came. It just was just announced for Blu-ray. It took a really long time to get this movie on Blu-ray, which is shocking because I know it has a lot of fans, and it's now going to be available in February, so I'll be picking that Blu-ray up. Carl Reiner directed this movie. He's, you know, of course, a legend. We lost him last year, but to me, one of his best movies. It's just so entertaining from beginning to end. Like, all the characters, they're all special in their own way. It just, I love Kelly Jo Minter, of course, Chainsaw and Dave, and Courtney Thorne Smith pining for surfing. It's kind of funny. he does a better job in this movie about handling a crush than some of the other
teachers. Arguably he does the best job of handling that situation.
He gets an A. He gets an A for that. For sure. I love Kirstie Alley in the movie. I think she's great. A good pairing of the two. I mean, it's unfortunate that she became a crazy Trumper, but hey, you know, she's entertaining to watch here. So and then Shawnee Smith, of course. Great. I like the guy from April Fool's Day who spends the whole movie sleeping. Ken Olin. That's a funny bit. Of course.
So, you know, there is a weird scene here. So when Mark Harmon goes to that strip club, there's no buildup. Like, one night he just goes to a strip club and he poses as like a Playboy reporter and he's asking questions. You know, it's like suddenly a night in heaven kind of, but and so I feel like there's some large like storyline that just got taken out of the movie. But I don't care, you know.
Maybe
it's all good.
Maybe there'll be deleted scenes, hopefully.
What is he doing there?
We just kind of buy it anyway.
You go to watch his student strip, maybe? I don't know.
Yeah, speaking of stripping, of course, Anna Maria, the foreign exchange student, stripping down
hard on bodies
the beach.
Too
on the beach scene was very memorable for a lot of people.
I only know that actress from Hard Bodies 2, which is a movie I really love. And I remember reading she's not in fact Italian, she's like from South America, is that right?
Like Argentinian or something,
This
movie has a tie to Just One of the Guys. I think for the same writer. Jeff Franklin wrote both movies. He wasn't the original writer on Just One of the Guys. I think he came in and revised some things, but he rewrote both movies. He's credited as both movies, which is fun. I'm a big fan of summer school.
Me too.
My number one here is the TV spot.
There's only one thing wrong with Kate's life. She does everything right. But she never knew what she was missing until she met Mr. Wrong.
Why are your clothes so dumb?
You're dumb.
I'm a bull player.
You're gonna get it this time. You are gonna get it bad.
I'm ready. Jill Klaber, Michael Douglas, Charles Grodin. It's My Turn, rated R. Coming soon to a selected theater near you.
Okay, that's It's My Turn. Of course, starring Jill Klaberth. Klaberg. What did I say, Klaberg? Oh,
boy. Jill Klaberg.
Okay, I can't say it's late, so that's my excuse. But there it is, Klaberg. So Jill Klaberg and Michael Douglas, his second appearance on this podcast. So Jill Klaberg plays a math teacher, a mathematics professor, who traces her going to her dad's wedding in New York City. And then there she meets her future brother-in-law.
Yes.
Played by Michael Douglas as a once famous ball player, I guess now past his prime. And they meet at the wedding, and then it sparks fly in an interesting, a very interesting way. I recommend watching those scenes alone, because that's what initially drew me to this movie. Like their initial meeting and then the date that follows it.
Yes.
Plays out in almost like a kind of real time way. And it's just really, really cool and interesting to watch, just to see their chemistry unfold on the screen. It's a kind of spectacular, actually, them in this movie. Of course, she has a boyfriend back home, played by Charles Grodin, who kind of, it's very clear that he's not as into her as he should be, because, you know, Jill Klaber, come on. And then you just see that relationship, and then of course her parents and her dad rather, and marrying someone, and then kind of the, you know, where that goes, but mostly this relationship that she finds herself in, and as a professor, but also she's there in New York City to possibly get a job. I think it's at Columbia University, right? She's like a job interview in Columbia. At Columbia to take a job there. So will she get her job, or will she have a relationship with Michael Douglas? The movie will answer those questions. But really, this is a movie about lead performances and chemistry, and I just find that the pairing of the two, for some reason, just really works for me, and just draws me into this movie every time I watch it. This is directed by Claudia Wheel. A director that I like a lot. She made a movie in the 70s called Girlfriends, which I really love, starring Melanie Mayron and her relationship with her friend. So it was a relationship movie, but it really is a special movie. It's My Turn, and I don't know, I put it my number one just because I was really feeling it today. Have you seen it before?
I have. Yeah, and I love this movie. I mean, it's a fun, I detest math. I detest baseball.
Yeah.
I should not like this movie, but I do, for the same reasons that you just, I mean, the lead performances are great. Michael Douglas is great. Jill Clay Bush, or whatever her name is.
Oh boy.
she's great. And you know, this, at the start of the podcast, you know, you talked about like in you know, you like seeing movies where you can see the teacher's like life outside of the classroom. I think this is a really good example of this, because to me, when I see her, I know who that teacher is. Yeah. You know, she's Kate, she can like write on the chalkboard, turn around, talk to a student, have perfect writing on the board. She's not covered in chalk. Like, she is a model teacher. And I mention this because I could never do that. When I left my classroom, it looked like I had dumped flour all over my clothes. Like, I couldn't walk and chew gum at the same time, but she can. And yeah, she's obviously very good at her job, and her life is a little bit of a mess. But she's figuring it out, and she never gets any of the answers. And at the end, you don't really know where it can go. But I mean, to me, I feel like the strength of the movie rests really on Jill Clayburgh's shoulders. Yep. And I love watching her. I'm sort of obsessed with that generation of actresses. I mean, obviously Diane Keaton and Ellen Burstyn, Geraldine Chaplin, you know, they, I don't know, these actresses, they're all so beautiful, but they're also really imperfect. And when you watch them, you know, they kind of make it okay if you're not so perfect also. And I always get that sense when I'm watching her. And the other thing I noticed about this movie and all of these movies is, how are these teachers affording these houseboats and beach houses and beautiful lofts in Chicago? I mean, I missed the boat with my salary, because I couldn't afford those things. They do have she has a really cool Chicago apartment.
She does. Yeah.
Yeah. And yeah, I don't know. I think it's interesting to watch her relationship with Charles Grodin. I mean, it's like, how did that happen? I mean,
probably a comfortable thing that they were comfortable with each other, but maybe they got too comfortable with each other, because he just seems to be oblivious to her most of the time.
Yeah. And you know, I'm sorry if I'm giving away spoilers, but I like the discussion. I won't give away spoilers, but I like the discussion that they have at the end. I think it's like really adult and mature, nobody screams or yells,
It feels real. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. It's really good.
It's a big studio romance, but it's still like, you know, it still feels that it came out in 1980, but it's still feeling that 70s-ness. And so there's a bit of realism there, which is nice. Of course, you get to see New York City and all its glory at that time period too, which is another highlight for me. Of course, I have to put a New York movie in there.
Yes. Well, I'll tell you what's not real: staying up late in bed at night to do math problems. No,
maybe
thanks.
Maybe not. But she's, you know, her life is a mess, but she's a model teacher. That's what
she is. She goes to bed doing math.
She loves it that much. And I confess, in seventh grade, I had a huge, huge crush on my math teacher, Mrs. Calamarino, wherever you are. I tried to do really good in that class to get attention, so I did.
Okay, so yeah, that was released by Columbia Pictures on October 24th, 1980. It grossed $11 million at the box office. Just to give you an idea what was playing at the time, Motel Hell, Gloria, Private Benjamin, Times Square, Terror Train, Fate to Black, Loving Couples, Stardust Memories, First Deadly Sin, The Elephant Man, Divine Madness, Hopscotch, The Awakening, Halloween, which played every Halloween in the late 70s and early 80s, Song of the South, Black Stallion, The Stuntman, Resurrection, My Bodyguard, Borderline, Ordinary People, The Black Hole, Dressed to Kill, and The Blue Lagoon. Clearly a great time for movies.
All right, so those are our lists. Let's read out lists from pals on the show. Let's see, what do we got here today? Bill Banks wrote in: "This should be a great podcast. Some of my favorites and most watch: Searching for Bobby Fischer, Summer School, Renaissance Man, gets a lot of hate, but I find it really sweet and watchable. Mr. Holland's Opus. Obviously, I love the trope of people starting as something else and then learning that they have a talent as a teacher. Class of 1984, Rushmore, and my favorite, Stand and Deliver, for the crazy almost performance. That amazing Craig Safin score, and the lump in my throat I get at the end crawl every time."
Oh,
thank you, Bill. Yeah, Craig Safin. I am partial to his scores too. Tristan Lofting: "Teachers, 1984 is very underrated, even though it's flawed. I wish it had been cohesive, consistent, and even darker in tone, because I love the performances by Nick Nolte, Joe Beth Williams, and Richard Mulligan." And I totally agree. Teachers is a movie I want to love, but something off about it. And it could be, yeah, maybe because the tone is very kind of all over the place.
Same. I know, the same. But you so know what I do love it, from yeah. Teachers? There, I know, the cast is amazing. And I love the song, the 38 special song.
That's right. Ralph Macchio was in it too. Our friend Ben Schur wrote in Savage Streets, Music of the Heart, and To Sir With Love. James Benj, Dangerous Minds, To Sir With Love, Bad Teacher, and To Die For. Lego Logan, Teachers, Dead Poet Society, The Substitute, Dangerous Minds, Kindergarten Cop, Mr. Holland's Opus, School of Rock, 187, and The Faculty. Chris Moore, Mr. Holland's Opus, Kindergarten Cop, The Faculty, and The First Story in the House of the Dead. Carlito, The Principal, The Substitute, Class of 1984, Class of 1999, Goodbye, Mr. Chips, To Sir With Love, Kindergarten Cop, but the best of all these teachers' movies is The Karate Kid. Mm. Ara Alishan, our pal Ara, I second Class of 1984 and would also add Class of 1999, Kindergarten Cop, and They're Playing with Fire. I have a feeling.
Ah, cool.
we got another fan of They're Playing with Fire. Yay.
Thanks, Ara.
I have a feeling I'm forgetting a ton of good ones. But no, you mentioned the good ones. Andrew Rooney, A Night in Heaven, 1983.
Right.
I love that it's his only pick.
Me too.
Marcus Roberts, Mr. Holland's Opus, Cameron Perry, Class of 1984, Adam Ayatollah, Summer School, and Cooties. Brian Pruting, the original Goodbye, Mr. Chips, Charles Campbell Peak, Unman, Withering, and Zigo. I need to look those movies up. Roberto Diaz, Lean on Me, Meat Hook Cinema, Female Trouble, Mr. Weinberger, Mr. Weinberger, Davin Davenport is eating a meatball sandwich right out in class, and she's been passing notes. Oh, and educating Rita. Thank you, Simon. Rebecca Fairbanks, The Substitute, Notes on a Scandal, The Prime of Miss Joan, Jean Brody. Whew, that's quite a list. Jake J. Butterbaum, Bad Teacher and Summer School, Kajagoogoo Man, aka Eric from The Hysteria Continues. It's schmaltzy and hackneyed, but I love Mr. Holland's Opus. Also, Raiders of the Lost Ark has Indy is an archaeology lecturer. Don't make me say that again. Film Matters, The Emperor's Club, and Orange County come to mind. Vestron movies, One Flick to Rule Them All, Class of 1984, followed hopefully by Jim Belushi in The Principal. Chris Cook, 64, Class of 1999. And then lastly, 10 from Dimitrios Patsiaras. Stand and Deliver, Mr. Holland's Opus, The Substitute, Raiders of the Lost Ark, Teachers, Lean on Me, Election, A Beautiful Mind, School of Rock, and Kindergarten Cup. I love that Class of 84, Class of 99 got a lot of love. I even noticed a substitute appear on a lot of lists, and Summer School, of course.
And they're playing with fire.
Yay! Thank you so much, guys, for joining us on this little education adventure. It's been an education. Thank you so
From
much.
From Sybil Danning to Joe Clayburgh in a single podcast.
Exactly. Yeah. We got all the great actors. All the great actors. this has been fun. We'll be back for episode 39. Thank you, everyone out there, for supporting the show and on Patreon. It means a lot. And I hope you're enjoying the 1991 series. If you haven't listened to them all already, we just wrapped up and the new one's out there. And who knows what will happen in 2022. I'm assuming there'll be some sort of 1992 podcast. We'll see. And we'll see what we can talk about soon, Daniel. It's been a lot of fun, for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, totally fun.
Oh, how can they reach you? How can they reach out to you if they want to?
Instagram, XanaDude5000. That's all. That's where I am now.
and that's basically, this podcast. There is a Retro Movie Love page, but... Cinema Demeep has a Instagram page. That's the best way to reach out and or just to check out what I've been getting on Blu-ray lately. It's mostly most of the posts. So thank you guys, and we'll talk soon. Take care. Ciao for now.
Dance movies. It's called Lambada, and so that makes the title very easy to remember.
What is that? The Lambada!
One of two quickie dance films brought about by the publicity surrounding a bump and grind Brazilian dance craze. Basically, you just hook pelvises and go at it on the dance floor. Now, I had very low expectations when I went to see this film, and yet I enjoyed it, much to my amazement. There is something, I think, about the dance musical form that can override even the most hackneyed script. Lambada is a story of a high school math teacher with a split personality. By day, he teaches rich kids. By night, he returns to his Latino roots and dances at the local club where Lambada is the rage.
Mind if I cut in?
Hell yeah!
Sandy, what are you doing here?
After dancing, he teaches the local poor kids some math so they can get a high school diploma. Lambada concludes not with a dance contest, as you might expect, but with a math contest between the rich and the poor. J. Eddie Peck is solid as the teacher, and Melora Hardin is captivating, I think, as the student who is infatuated with him. They're both very good on the dance floor, even though the director, Joe Silberg, doesn't know how to shoot the full-length dancer's body, like Fred Astaire used to do. He's always shooting mostly from the butt up. This movie becomes an instant guilty pleasure for me, a film I'm almost embarrassed to admit held my attention. I'm almost embarrassed, but not really, because I'm prepared to defend it now against Roger's sure attack.
You should be embarrassed, Gene, because first of all, this is not a good dance musical. It has very, very few dance sequences in it. They're badly lit, badly photographed, badly choreographed.
Right.
And you're quite right. The camera is so high on most of these people that you cannot go to this movie and find out from it how the Lambada is danced. I don't have a clue how to do the Lambada from having seen this movie. Then we get to the story, which involves teaching the poor kids how to find the cosine and use a protractor in order to line up their pool shots. This is like, I don't know if I want to call this movie Clean Dancing instead of Dirty Dancing, or it's like a remake of Stand and Deliver. Who in the world wants to go to a Lambada movie that ends with a trigonometry B? I mean, this movie,
Roger,
the audience I sat there and saw it with, they were stunned. The last 20, 15 minutes of this movie consists of mathematical questions.
I know.
Now,
wait a second.
What does it have to do with anything?
They were stunned. I was stunned. And I thought, you know, this picture is obviously combining two wildly different things. First of all, I didn't even believe that they were in high school. When it says high school at the end, wait a second, I'm criticizing it now. When they said high school at the end, I was shocked, I thought it was college.
Well, every high school student in this movie is played by an actor who
26.
Looks like he's in his 20s.
Absolutely.
Yes.
And I like that about it. And what
why
I need
did
to
you
say,
like that
wait,
about
I'm going to tell you exactly why.
I'm sure you
something
will.
Something that I said, the musical form, Gets
well, then
me.
Where's the music? That's the key flaw in your argument. The musical form overcomes everything. There isn't enough music, and there isn't enough
Can I ask you something? Were you bored by the picture, or were you captivated by it?
I was stunned by the picture. I was stunned that anyone would make this picture. I was stunned by the fact that...
There are parts of it that are so bad, and there are parts of it that are strong, and I think you do know a little bit how to do the dance. You just get close and work out.
Gene, I knew that when I was 17 years old, and this movie
Reminds
doesn't
you.
Know as much as I knew when I was 17.